All right, we might as well start. We might as well start. Why not? Why not? Oh, right off the bat. Oh, it flickers. Let it flicker. It's a beautiful color pattern anyway. Crickets are just hammering it out there. I mean, they're just in full throat right now. It's very nice. Very beautiful day here today. Beautiful day. I'm tired because the Holy Spirit keeps having me do new exercises. I said, can't I just jump rope, you know, and get good at it? Oh, you're good enough at it. Here's another one. What? I get so tired doing that. Well, try this. It keeps doing this. Same way with the spiritual path. You keep thinking, no, I've got it, almost gotten the Holy Spirit, then shifts you, go, no, over here. What? I was really good at this. You know what the key to enlightenment, a key, is just let someone else be a better teacher than you are. Just, you know, say, okay, I'm not going to be the greatest teacher, or that's fine. I'm just going to abide right now. That's all. It is super critical going forward that you be engaged with your own path. Be engaged with your own path. Be really into your own path. Whatever it is, it means you have to be creative enough to stay engaged with your own path. And don't allow the world consciousness, the consciousness that believes there is a world, believes there's time, space, process, and form, believe that is taking that seriously, is taking pretending that we're not already enlightened seriously, that group, do not let them grab a hold of these aspects of your life and intrigue you and pull you into them. This is absolutely crucial. This is why I'm into my own path. I'm into my own nutrition. I'm into my own exercise. I'm into my own spirituality. I'm into all of this. I have to keep it interesting to myself so I don't start straying into the spider's web. And everyone has to do this. Coming up, it's essential to be really into your own path. You know, do stuff that's creative. Allow the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit will get you into your own path. That's the genius of it. The Holy Spirit will have you doing stuff that for you, say, wow, this is really interesting. I really feel like I want to do this. Now, someone else may be completely different. They may not be into what you're doing at all. But you have to stay into your own path. Coming up now in the world, this is going to be necessary, really necessary. Now, if your own path has you watching videos or doing this or something, well, that's if that's interesting to you and it's part of your path, that's great. Then do it. It doesn't mean you block everything else out at all. It's not like you become negative to the world. It's that it's simply that you allow the Holy Spirit to present the world to you. So, it's not about rejection or denouncing the world or rejecting the world in that context. It's that you realize that ultimately, you know that ultimately the realization is there's never been a world. We've never experienced, quote unquote, a world or a body or a person or things or anything like that, actually. It's all make-believe. It's all pretending. It's a great pretending. Very creative, very beautiful. But so let the Holy Spirit be the one who presents your creativity to you so that you can honor your creativity at the same time awaken from the pretense that we're not already awake. Yeah. So what I encourage everyone is to stay involved with your own path and don't let it get hooked by the fishermen and fisherwomen who are fishing. And we've gone over that many, many times. Why are they fishing? What are they fishing for? Et cetera, et cetera. We don't need to constantly talk about it. So we're in a slightly different mood right now. What we're saying is stay very positive about your own path. And the only way to do that, ultimately, is to allow the Holy Spirit into your life. That's the only way to ultimately do it. It's the only way. It's the only way to do it, ultimately do it. Because only the perfect genius of the Holy Spirit is able to keep you engaged with your path, which your path becomes your life. It is the life you're living. And so you love your path. You love your life because it's actually the path, a 360-degree immersion in the path. So I love my life because it is the path. It is the path to recognition, to acceptance, to abidance. It is the Holy Spirit's play. It's the Holy Spirit's play. So I'm loving the Holy Spirit's play. It did many things for me today that are very, very wowish. So when in order to allow the Holy Spirit's play to be your life, you have to be very proficient in this wow, because it will continually wow you. You will be wowed. You say, "Just that is just so extraordinary. What it is doing is so extraordinary. It continuously surprises you. You keep thinking that you've got your expectations lined up, and then the Holy Spirit, you know, does this. It's like, what? And the Holy Spirit is so amazing that it's funny. And so you become very humorous and full of good cheer and humor, because you know that around the next quarter, the Holy Spirit's just going to completely wow you. And you think you have it figured out, and you find you don't have the Holy Spirit figured out. You don't have the path figured out. I could tell you something today that is just so amazing, so amazing. I brought my skateboard with me, and I wanted to try skating today, and I found this pathway to skate along, a trail like to skate. I just stumbled upon it. I said, wow, you know, I'm going to, but I had to do something else first. So I did this something else, and I met this man, and we had this amazing conversation. He works for extremely wealthy people, and he helps them get rid of stuff. And he said, wait a minute, I have something for you. He went and got me this belt. And he says, here, it was like a super expensive belt. It was a black crocodile belt. He said, here, take it. And I thought, huh. And then I looked at it and said, oh my gosh, you know, I don't wear, you know, animal skin, crocodile. I don't wear reptilian crocodile stuff, like the crocodile skin. But I took it from him. I didn't want to say anything. I took it from him. Okay. And so then I'm going through this path, and then he says something very interesting. He's talking, he says, you know, God, he says, the best thing to do is to live in the moment. He says, because you never know what's going to happen next. Stay in the moment. We're in this very deep conversation that just naturally arises. And he said, who knows? After talking with me, you may die. He told that to me. And I was going to say, I don't think I'm going to die. But I let him say, I said, huh, that's interesting. Someone saying, you might, after talking with me, you might die. You may just, the next thing you do, you may be dead. That's what he said. So I'm going back to this path, and it's asphalt. It's black, a black path, and it's this thin path, like a belt. And I'm looking at it and say, okay, I want to try skating this. But I don't feel quite right today, like skating. It's just something, I don't feel coordinated. I don't feel aware. I feel absent-minded. And suddenly I realized that black crocodile belt that he gave me, I suddenly connected it with this black asphalt path. And my feeling was, I don't really want to wear this belt. I don't really want to do this. And then him saying, you might die after beating me. And I said, you know what? I feel like it's a dangerous thing right now. Skating this is going to be a dangerous thing. I'm not in sync with it properly. And so I just turned around and left. And the Holy Spirit validated that, so he did the right thing. That is great. So somebody just says, hey, wait a minute, I got something for you. He was like getting rid of all this stuff that some super, super rich people didn't want anymore. He says, here. He gave me a bunch of stuff. And he said, he made a purpose of giving me that black belt. And right away I said, uh-oh, something isn't right. A black crocodile belt. That immediately got my attention. And then saw that this narrow asphalt path I was thinking of skating along was this something I don't want to do. Don't want to do it. So, you know, it's just like my life is like that. But the Holy Spirit is always doing something very unexpected. Like, he's got my back. You know, the Holy Spirit has my back. And I'm sure it keeps the Holy Spirit quite busy. I keep the Holy Spirit employed because I'm always seeming to step into trouble. Earlier in the day, I stepped into some more trouble. I missed my exit. I was being very absent-minded. I was in very much of a sort of a shock this morning for some reason. Very much, very wowish. And then I took it like later on that maybe I should take this path that I had taken. And I went there and I started to take a hike in a place which I had vowed never to hike again. I said, well, maybe it's okay today. And so I was going to take a selfie, and I had a tape of the Beach Boys with me. I was going to put that on earphones. I was going to sing along as I took the hike to the Beach Boys and tape myself doing this. So I started out on the trail, and I hit the camera, and I hit the tape recorder on, and I started singing, and I was having trouble. I said, God, I'm not sounding good. Wow, I'm really messing up. What's going on? I couldn't figure out what is wrong. Something's wrong. Something's really wrong. And suddenly I realized that the tape recorder, for some reason, has never done this before. Never, ever, ever. It was playing at half speed. And the song was going, I go, woo, 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 woo. We're always first to hit the lot and wave to the man in blue, yeah. And it's like, ah, and I was trying to fix it. I couldn't fix it. It kept playing at half speed, so I couldn't sing it right. I said, ah, and suddenly I said, you know what? This isn't working out. Something's wrong. This is a sign from the Holy Spirit. Get out of here. So I turned around. I'm walking back towards my vehicle, and there's this sign, trail sign, on the back of this trail sign facing where I was walking towards. There was this white decal there, and it said, Freak Alert. And had this skull and crossbones, this terrible-looking death symbol on it, Freak Alert. And I said, whoa, yeah. And this is the same trail with that rattlesnake. I met that rattlesnake that gave me the terrible scare. And I said, I'm never coming back here. And now I have this thing, Freak Alert. In other words, this place is dangerous. And another thing happened that you'll get a kick out of. As I'm walking up this trail, I suddenly have this urge. I have to go to the bathroom very severely. I said, where did this come from? And it was so terrible that it also factored into my decision to leave. I said, my gosh, if I keep walking up this trail, I have to find a bathroom immediately. So I get back my vehicle, get in, and I drive to the store there. I said, I got to go inside and use the bathroom. And I pull in, there's all these very freakish looking people around. I mean, really, really crazy looking people. I'm telling you, it was scary. This is a very freaky place, actually. Mountain place, actually. It's people, you can tell they're heavily on drugs, a lot of them. Drug shirts, you just look at them, it's just obvious. In fact, everyone I saw, I could see that they're drug abusers. And so I went to this store, and I couldn't find any bathroom. And so I just walked out. And I said, I got my bills, I'm getting out of here. And then something told me, said, you know what? I bet if I just leave this place and get back to what I'm supposed to be doing, this terrible urge to go to the bathroom is going to go away. And you know what? It did. It did. It did. Vanished. It vanished. And I said, wow. Holy Spirit is using many means, can use many means. And it certainly did there. It slowed the tape recorder down. It gave me this terrible urge to go to the bathroom where I had to flee the place. Then it showed me that decal. I said, this place is not a good place to go. Really, really bad place. That rattlesnake months ago warned me about this place. Thank you, rattlesnake. I'm telling you, the Santa Cruz Mountains is not a good place to go, okay? Let me tell you this. It's never been a good place to go. And from the people that I saw up there, there's way too many drugs up there. And that's not a good thing. And you can see what it does to people. They're not stable at all. Holy Spirit said, get out of there. That's not your place. So, again, I keep the Holy Spirit very busy, to say the least. But at least I'm willing to listen, you know, and not be hard-headed. And I say, oh, okay, I'm not supposed to do this. Okay, thank you. And I don't do it. What the Holy Spirit wants me to be doing is practice falling dead. As it got me in this another cushion, this wonderful cushion. This floating styrofoam thing for pools. I found it, and I tried. So I tried falling backwards, not just falling backwards, and boom. And I did that quite a few times this afternoon. It works great, but I'll tell you what. This is exhausting. It's really interesting. If you just like fall backwards, try falling backwards, like that, and you will feel very tired. And your nerves are like like this. Extremely interesting what the Holy Spirit has me doing. So you talk about being interested in your path. The Holy Spirit will develop a path for you that is very interesting to you. And it's going to be your own unique path. Don't get into this thing of like, oh, someone else has a super interesting, unique path. Therefore, that has to be my path or something like that. No. You can get inspiration, like you can get inspiration here. Okay, but your path is going to be your own unique path. There can be similarities. That is fine. And there can be differences. That is fine. Trust it. The Holy Spirit also got me another type of trampoline today. Was promptly busted when I was jumping on it and I had to fix it. That was interesting. I was worried about that. It happened, but I was okay. That was another experience, right? You're jumping on a trampoline and suddenly, whoa, you fall through. You know, it's like, what? okay. It's all good now. But in jumping on that, I was in a whole different thing. And that it also causes this fatigue, is a different practice. So, again, we love to fixate. We love to fixate, whether it's on a guru or a physical exercise or whatever. And we think, oh, I've got it now. But what we're really doing is we're fixating. And the Holy Spirit will help us break free of that fixation. And of course, it is stressful and tiring, but it's also very interesting and rewarding and yields great dividends. Sri Sri Anand, my Ma, let me know. Don't fixate on me. He says, you've done enough. You need to get a 360 degree experiencing. So don't fixate on me at this point. No, that's enough. Enough is enough. So the gurus know this, that they know it's your path. You have to make the path interesting, and you have to accept God's help in that, because the ego will just have you fixate on something and say, see how good you're doing? You're jumping rope every single morning, and this is all you're doing, but you're really great at it. You're an expert at jumping rope. And the Holy Spirit said, you know, I wanted to like see how many I could do. Can I do 500? That was my goal. But the Holy Spirit kind of nixed all that. And said, no, you just do 100, you know, a couple sets of 100. Don't worry about the number, how many you do, it's not important. And then said, well, there's other things you need to do. So I said, the Holy Spirit, like lately, I want to go hiking. Holy Spirit said, you already hiked. I said, yeah, I know, but Holy Spirit says, I got to something else I want you to do. Try falling down dead. Yeah, what? Well, that's more difficult than hiking. I feel more tired doing that than hiking, you know, a mountain. I said, shoot. You keep coming up with stuff that throws me off, you know, off balance, so to speak. So it's very intriguing, isn't it, what the Holy Spirit does? It's more intriguing than what the ego has us doing. And so you have to be more intrigued by the path the Holy Spirit is unfolding for you. Be more intrigued by that than you are the path the ego, the world, is unfolding for you. more intrigued. Of course, the ego will seem intriguing if you give your attention to it. That's what it's trying to do. It's trying to intrigue you. You see some yoga girl, you know, running or doing whatever she's doing, and there it's like they're saying, "Look at me! I'm in this very intriguing situation and path and all this. My life is so intriguing, so interesting. And maybe you should pay attention to this." If you give your attention to that, you're going to start feeling that there's some intrigue there, something interesting. Or what's important is just don't give any attention to it at all and stay with the Holy Spirit. This is my heartfelt advice and my experience from a lot of hindsight and a lot of experience here. Of course, the world will seem intriguing if that's how you want to be intrigued. So just admit this. Of course, yes, yes, yes. Of course, yoga girls can seem very intriguing. Yoga guys, you know, whatever you want to call it. They're full of it, you know. They're really full of it. And if you want to be misled, they'll be, you know, they will seem to have, you know, be very intriguing mislead. So the ego, our creativity, which of the ego is just our creativity, pretending that we're not already perfect, is going to be very intriguing. So we have to turn to the Holy Spirit and have this very intriguing path. And I don't know why this is still, you know, this thing just keeps doing that, but whatever, it's intriguing in its own right. You have to make the whole, turn to the intriguing path of the Holy Spirit, which is very intriguing. And don't try to integrate the two. See, this is where many go astray. Because they're completely different directions, actually. One is leading you to despair. The other is leading you to effortless bliss. You can't even describe what it's leading you to. But you will feel that you could call it abidance. But there's nothing to call it, really. But let's just say it's that which has no regrets arising in it whatsoever. Okay, it is that which has no regrets arising in it whatsoever. And the ego, as Jesus has pointed out to us, can make the path towards despair very intriguing to start out with. It front loads it all to try to get you into it. And then you find yourself getting entangled and entangled and entangled and entangled. And a sense of despair starts arising in you. This is exactly how it works. So the world may seem interesting, superficially, intriguing and creative and such, but the purpose, there's a purpose designed to the world, and the purpose is to lead us into absolute despair, ultimately, to change what we are, to change what we are. This is the whole purpose of existence, is to change what we are. And so we can candy coat it in many, many, many creative ways, but it's all the same, all the same, all the same, same purpose. So you have to choose which path you're going to take. You can't take both of them. Cannot have your cake and eat it too. So when I drive along, for instance, I'm, you know, I see some motion here, some person, I say, it's just a body. It's a person, a body. It's nothing to judge there. There's nothing there. And I don't even look. I don't first look and judge it and say, okay, this is a mistake if you do that. Don't judge the world. Don't judge the world. Judge not lest ye be judged. Don't judge the world. Just ask the Holy Spirit to keep your attention where it needs to be. That's the whole key to it. The entire thing is a play of attention. Okay, this whole situation we're in is a play of attention, whether you go with the ego or the Holy Spirit. Your attention is being played one way or the other. Your attention is being played. So are you going to let the ego play your piano? If attention is a piano, are you going to let the ego sit down and play the piano? Or are you going to let the Holy Spirit sit down and play your piano? You're hearing the music of either the ego or the Holy Spirit. Now, if you try to say, well, let's both have them sit down and play, you're just going to have confusion. It's going to sound very confusing to you. And then you're going to try and clarify it, and then you're going to think too much and then have problems sleeping and stress it, and then despair arises. So, and the Holy Spirit won't sit down with the ego anyway, because it knows the terrible effect it would have upon you. So again, just think about, what kind of music do you want to hear? Do you want to invite the ego to play your piano? Well, it may start out with some big crescendo, and you think, oh boy, you know, something's coming here. I'm not sure what, but, and then it starts, and, you know, and you hear it like, ah, that's like, I don't know, it's kind of weird. The syncopation and everything is just kind of, I feel like odd. You know, I feel like kind of like, so what is that feeling I'm feeling? Well, we're not sure what that feeling is, and we're intrigued by it. But I can tell you what that feeling is. It's despair. It's despair. But spirit, not knowing despair, it really can't know despair, but it can pretend, you might say, to know despair. It can take it seriously. It can forget to laugh at the notion of despair and therefore take it seriously. And so it seems as though we're experiencing despair. We feel like, what is this? It's very intriguing. I'm not sure what this is. It's kind of a weird feeling, and you think like, huh, I want to kind of find out about this. What's going on here? Well, the truth is, it's despair that you're feeling. And you're feeling it because this is how we imagine that we can change what we are, change spirit, change the idea that we are in the mind of God, that which we are, which is an idea in the mind of God. This is the feeling, this is how we're trying to accomplish the impossible, is despair. So we're suckers for despair because it seems different. Like, oh, this is not bliss, so what is it? This world's kind of weird. It's kind of intriguing. It's the gingerbread house, you know, and the wicked witches, and they're trying to lure us into the gingerbread house or something, you know. Yeah. There's, come on and taste these treats here. And you taste the treats, you say, oh, what is that weird feeling? I feel sort of like separate or estranged or alienated from myself, or there's something, this is very odd. So, oh yes, but it becomes more interesting, you know, they say. And it becomes even odder. It becomes very odd. And it becomes very awkward. And it becomes very weird. And on and on and on and on until ultimately you realize, wow, it's total mental chaos, which is designed to generate this pure despair of, I'll never figure it out. I thought I had everything figured out. Now it's completely chaotic. And there's no basis of which to put anything back together again, because where do you start in chaos, total chaos? And then you feel like, you think you feel despair. At least you're thinking, the thought of despair arises, certainly. And if you take it seriously, then you seem to be in a big, big trouble. And they say, oh my gosh, what do I do? And the Holy Spirit then says, don't worry, I'll just let me play your piano, and let you can hear the music I play for you. And you say, wow, okay, go ahead, I got nothing to lose. And the Holy Spirit starts playing the piano, and you say, wow, I love that. That's way better than what the ego was doing. And so we just invite the Holy Spirit to play the piano, your piano. It's very simple. Your job is just to full stop in the wow. And when you decide that's your only job, only thing you need to do, this is when the path goes very quickly and very profoundly. Because you don't need to describe anything or explain anything at all. The Holy Spirit's not asking you to explain anything to the Holy Spirit. It's not like the Holy Spirit's playing your piano and the Holy Spirit says, how's it going? How's it sound? You say, well, it sounds great. Well, then the Holy Spirit doesn't say, could you explain what I'm doing? I'm not really sure what I'm doing. Can you describe what I'm doing? Can you explain what I'm doing? No, the Holy Spirit doesn't. The Holy Spirit knows what it's doing. We don't need to explain it to the Holy Spirit. We don't need to help the Holy Spirit teach anything to the Holy Spirit. No. Our job is just to be willing to be really, really knocked out by super positivity, knocked out by it. And I continue to get knockout blows. I really do. I had a dream last night. It was quite extraordinary. I was playing this 9-hole golf course. It was just, I don't know, it was kind of odd. We were playing it. And then we got to the final, the 9th hole. And there, a number of us were standing on the green and we were yakking away and talking. And these things just didn't seem right. And then in the fairway there, there was one other in our group. And he hit his approach shot, and it bounced on the green. It looked like a great shot, rolled to the back of the green, and somehow it then rolled back across the green and rolled off the green back to where he was. And we said, "Whoa, that is really bad luck. That's terrible." Yeah, what? And then the golfer started chewing us out. He said, "You guys, you know, you're just creating so much disturbance and distraction, and you're not focused, and you're not, you know, doing what you should be doing." And we kind of were like really kind of shocked. And what was even more shocking was that the golfer was Tiger Woods. And so then Tiger hits his shot again. I mean, he hit a fantastic drive on this hole. Like, I don't know, it was like a par 4 or par 5, whatever. He was way up there. And he hit a shot again to this very tricky, treacherous green. And we watched it, and the ball went right in the hole. And we're just like, whoa. And then we all just started clapping, shouting and clapping. You know, it's just like, wow, Tiger, you're the man. I mean, that's something that Tiger Woods does. Okay, that's what he does. And in the dream, if you see Tiger Woods show up in the dream, that's yourself. It's great. Ability, and it's the finisher. Tiger's the finisher. And so, he, because of our laziness and our distraction and the way we are, he said he had trouble finishing and the ball rolled back to him. And they said, you know, I'm just going to, heck with this. I'm not even going to fool around with putting. I'm just going to hold a shot because these guys are just, you know, they don't get it. So I'm going to finish right away. So it's like a par 5. He holds his third shot. Said eagle. He's done. He's done. So he finishes early because he holds his fairway shot. So that's the genius, the spiritual genius within us. To have a dream like that means, you know, within me, I'm deciding just to finish it. You know, I can finish this now. Yeah, stop. I'm going to stop fooling around. There's too many knuckleheads here. Let me just hold a shot and be done with it. But we appreciate. We were like, wow. That's awesome. All this distraction in the world, and we just decide, it's decided, let's just finish it right now. Let's stop fooling around here. I'm just going to hold this shot. It's intentional. But before I went to bed, another situation happened where I was having this elaborate dream. I was kind of drowsy, and all these people, and there's a river, like an English canal, River Thames or something, with beautiful trees and people promenading, and it was just this whole world scene of all the stuff just happening. And I was just seeing this. I was saying, wow, isn't this interesting? And then suddenly something arose within me and says, hey, wait a minute. Why don't you back it off? I don't quite like what's happening. Let's back off this. And suddenly everything in this scene stopped and went in reverse. This dreaming. I was dreaming in reverse. Have you ever done that? So the people that were walking forward and promenading, suddenly they stopped, and then they just started backwards, like a tape, like a reversing a tape, like a videotape. Well, we had VCRs, we would reverse the videotape. They were going in reverse. The whole dream was going in reverse. I saw that, I said, wow, I'm dreaming this whole dream. Because I was aware, I had the thought, hey, let's back this off, let's go back. I was aware that I had this thought, I had this desire, and then it just happened instantly. And then I realized I'm the one who's dreaming this entire dream. this world. I was dreaming the entire world there, and all the activity in the world, and the water, the trees, everything was there. It was my own mind. My mind was projecting all of this like a projection, like a movie. And then I had it all go backwards. Now, that, you talk about a wow, right? That's how I went to sleep. Oh, I got to get up early again tomorrow. I have to keep getting up early. What is this? Wow. Okay. I just want to sleep in a little bit. I just need to... What is this? Oh, free space. There's very little free space. What's going on? I don't know what's going on. That's crazy. Okay. It shouldn't be happening like that. So we will continue talking. In the meantime, I will remedy the situation. I will try to. I thought I'd had this remedied, and apparently not. Okay. So, just get a sense of wow about what you experience. Because when you let the Holy sit down to your piano, you are going to be wowed. Okay, there's no doubt about it. So this is what I really, really, really am emphasizing. Okay, so there's a whole bunch of... What is this one? A bunch of captured files here. This one's the 30th. Okay. Let me just delete these. Let's see if they'll delete. If they will, I thought I deleted them. They're all back. You know, this is the problem, kind of. You're going to be wowed. You're going to be wowed. This is so crucial. So crucial. And you're going to be wowed in ways you didn't expect. And this is also extremely crucial. And you have to be willing to experience this. You know, so many of us, we fixate on some teaching and say, okay, Holy Spirit, I got it. You know, I don't need you. Thanks. You led me to Rama Maharshi. Thanks, I got it. See you later. There we go. We got some space now. 9 gigabytes. That's not that much. How can I use that so much space? That is so weird. Can't figure that one out. Okay. Anyway, we're fine. We're fine for now. So it's all good. We could fixate. Let's say we fixate on Rama Maharshi. You may say, okay, I got it, Holy Spirit. Don't need you anymore. Ramana's the guy. And I just need to, every day, just listen to what he says, and that's it. Is that the right thing to do? Shouldn't we say, Holy Spirit, it's your day. You play the piano. I'm just listening. Whatever you want to play, go ahead and play it. So, when you hear advice like to just drop your desire, do this. There's a lot of advice out there. But use this analogy of a piano. You have a piano in your room, and you invite the Holy Spirit to play the piano for you. And just don't have any expectation or of what the Holy Spirit's going to play. No desire that the Holy Spirit play anything in particular. No desire for the Holy Spirit play anything in particular. You're not shouting out requests saying, hey, I want to hear this song. You just say, I am simply, it's you. You play whatever you want to play, Holy Spirit, and I'm just going to listen. This is a very nice way of looking at effective, profound meditation, and you do it in your daily life as you're going along in your day continuously. Just it's your piano. You play whatever you want. I just trust you. So it's trust it. Ramana's great saying, trust it. It is extremely important. And don't be willful, because we may be trying to be great in some direction, but the Holy Spirit knows its only goal is to truly liberate us from pretension. pretending we're not perfect. Its only goal is to liberate us from our pretension that we're not already and have always been perfect, and that everyone's perfect. Its only goal is to liberate us from this pretension. So it knows its business perfectly well. And it's not interested in you becoming real great at this or great at that or that kind of stuff. Not necessarily at all. I said, Holy Spirit, I'm getting really good at this. I mean, if I just continue, I might get great at this. Holy Spirit said, No. That's enough of that. We're going to go over here. But I don't know how to do this over here. I'm no good at this. And like that. Holy Spirit's always been done this to me in my life. Is it never lets me get satisfied and really good at something. I was just getting good at this, and then you say, now I got to jump on this trampoline or do this or what? I'm not good at that. So it's very humbling. The priest last service, last Sunday, the homily is about humility, and how important that is. And it's very important. It's very humbling to take the spiritual path because the Holy Spirit keeps switching things up on you and you never seem to be getting, great at anything. Never seem to be getting great at anything. Holy Spirit, I want to be a virtuoso at this or that. And no, I'm just a stumbling, bumbling. I'm stumbling along the gutter. I feel so. But the Holy Spirit knows what it's doing. And so we just have to be accept our humble station in life. Like, I'm not really that good at anything. But I am pretty good at listening to the Holy Spirit play the piano. So I guess there's one thing I'm good at. But that's the one thing we want to be good at, isn't it? Let the Holy Spirit play whatever music it wants to play. And let us do our job in the listening and full stop in the wow of what's going on. You will be wowed. In ways that you just can hardly believe. It's like grace is always operating in your life. Everything that happens is grace. Someone confided in me today, sort of a deep, dark secret. I guess he felt, I'm going to take a risk here with this guy. He's a very unusual person, very unusual. I think he's got a brilliant, genius mind. He's able to flip the script just continuously. It's just amazing. He's so quick. And he said, everyone thinks I'm weird. I said, no, I know exactly what's like you. I don't think you're weird at all. And so I was just talking to him in such a way, very reaffirming, reassuring, because everyone hates on him so much. And he's always treated me great, and he's always had my back, and he's able to, when you get fixated, he's able to unfixate you, which is an extraordinary capacity, actually. But nobody appreciates it in his life. So apparently, he's had some trouble in his life, and he confided something in me. And I don't know if he was telling me the truth or not. You never know. But he might have been, because he alluded to it early months ago. But he told me, he said, I'm serious about this. I'm seriously, this is what happened in my life. And I think he was serious. It's pretty amazing. And I just didn't bother me the slightest bit. And I didn't dig at all. I didn't dig in it at all. It was just like, yeah, that's funny. We made a joke, joked about it and kept joking and everything. And so, he got something off his chest. He wanted to say something, and he did, and I guess he trusted in me enough to do it. That's pretty amazing. And I didn't freak out. I didn't dig at all. I didn't start to say, oh, really? Oh, you have a skeleton in your closet, a shady past. Oh, what happened? What happened? Why did you, what did you do to get yourself in trouble? And, all this kind of stuff. Oh, ain't it awful thing? I said the worst mistake they ever made was letting you out, man. Now they're really in trouble, The world let you free, Now you're really in trouble. They're really in trouble now. And so we had a great deal of laughter about it, and flipped the script and all that. And It's very interesting. I mean, it was shocking, really. Very wowish, and so this stuff just keeps happening to me like this. It's very wowish. It's because I allow the Holy Spirit to play the music. You see, it's your music. You know, I'm just a passenger. You're driving, so just be the passenger on the path. You're not driving. The Holy Spirit's driving. And sometimes you won't understand what is it doing. There's always a reason for it. The closest we get to the Holy Spirit is Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma and her Kayal, where she did nothing of her own volition at all. She let her inner guidance, which is the Holy Spirit, orchestrate everything. She was just passively, she said, I don't have anything, you know, of my own volition at all. Nothing, not even a shred, actually, she said. And so she would do things that were so amazing. People said, what are you doing? And she was having this darshan, and it's very intense, and an insect came and landed on her scarf or blanket or something that was next to her or whatever. And some devotee noticed it and like, oh my gosh, this is terrible, and went to, you know, brush the insect away. And she stopped them, grabbed their hand and stopped, says, no. Leave it alone. And then later on, again, the devotee had to try it, and tried like three times to get rid of the insect. And every time she stopped them. And then they noticed that this insect was absolutely still. And that Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma was very, very intent on what was happening. And then she said, the insect has just left its body. The consciousness just left the body. And then she instructed them to wrap it up in a scarf and take it to the Ganges and immerse it the same way you immerse a guru. And yeah, nobody could, just like, what? She says, you know, insects, everyone comes to this body for darshan, and you don't know who it is or what it is that's coming. And now she would do things, and then years later would bring it up, and the thread would weave through again, and people would say, oh my gosh, it's all woven together somehow. Grace is all woven together somehow. So the Leela, the play of grace, the Leela of grace, she was the closest thing to you know, seeing, to really experiencing the Holy Spirit in terms of someone here in the world. But we can experience the Holy Spirit directly in our own path. Directly, we experience the Holy Spirit doing things that we just say, well, why? You know, am I doing this? A lot of times I don't understand, why am I doing this? And the Holy Spirit says, pick this up, get this. Why? I don't know. And then later on, it's suddenly, I need something, like there's a problem comes up and I need something, and there it is. I say, oh my gosh, this was already known ahead of time, that this was needed. So the dance of grace is unfathomable to us. It really is. So we need not worry about that. That's the Holy Spirit's business. Our business is to wake up to our perfection. Okay, the spiritual path is really the Holy Spirit's business. It's not our business. It's not. As Jesus said, your only purpose is to awaken, is to forgive yourself for ever believing that you weren't awake, that you weren't perfect. Forgive yourself. That's your only purpose. Ram Maharshi said, your only purpose here is realization. Just your own realization is the greatest help you can possibly give humanity. That's it. That's your only purpose, really. So we don't have to understand the path or know the path. We just have to allow ourselves to awaken, to make this little shift of forgiveness that frees us from all regrets. That's our job. Explaining the path is not our job. Not really. And trying to describe it all or do it all, that's not our job. Our job is to allow the Holy Spirit to play the piano so we can hear the music and be inspired by it. And it will play differently for everyone. Now, I keep running into people, it's just nonstop now, and they need help. Everybody needs help, actually. The truth is, this is what's happening now. I find that the Holy Spirit's sending all these different beings to me, and I recognize they all need help in this way or that way or that way. But I don't know how to help. You know, I wish there was someone in the world I could send them to. You know, it's like you need a mentor. You know, you need some sort of, people need some sort of, it's like who you meet is very important. I want to introduce them to some friends. What makes the real difference in your life is who you meet. The people you meet, the ones that you're introduced to, someone introduces you to someone, and it totally changes your life. So my life has been extremely changed in a super positive way because of who I've met. You know, as they say, success is who you get introduced to, who you meet. And this is well known in culture, of success-oriented culture, is, you know, you get introduced to the right people, and that makes all the difference in your life, all the difference in terms of your success. If you don't meet those people, you know, your success is not going to be, you know, close to what it could have been. Because there's some people that just know how to bring you along, know how to get you in. You know, they introduce you to the right people here and here and here, and you become successful because of it. This is how it works here. This is how it works. They might recommend you. Say, hey, I really have this friend. I want to recommend them. I think they'd be really good in this position. And then so their friend then hires you. And then they then capitalize you. I think you'd be good at this business. I'll capitalize you. And then they introduce you to the right bankers, the right lawyers, this and the, and then the clients. They introduce you to clients. And before you know, you're up and running. You're up and running. This is how it works. It's who you know. It's who you know. So I've been super blessed because I've been introduced to the Dharma Kings. That's, you know, that's really super helpful. So I've literally met these Dharma Kings in spirit. My spirit has met their spirit. And so they have then managed, you know, helped me somehow the way they can help to have the right experiences and move towards success on the spiritual journey to recognizing that we've always been perfect and that anything other than that is just total delusion, pretending. So I've been super fortunate because they took an interest in me because of my work ethic and determination and perseverance and patience and all of that. They said, hey, we want to help him along. So they made a point of introducing themselves and say, we want to help you along. And they've done that. So having friends like the Dharma Kings is crucial for liberation. Crucial. Very, very important. So I'd like to be able to introduce those who I make the acquaintance of to the Dharma Kings, to someone, you know, that I say, look, I think you'd be really well. I think there's some people need supervision. They need supervision, especially those with brilliant minds in the world. I meet them all the time. It seems like, and I know for myself, I needed discipline and supervision, because this world freaks you out. This world is an insane asylum, where they think that generating despair is the answer. So here you are, your mind is telling them, flipping the script and saying, no, we're already perfect and we just need to abide in our inherent perfection. And they claim that you're crazy. You said you're crazy. You don't know what you're doing. No, you got to generate despair. That's the answer. So that really, really freaks you out. So those who, in my own experience, I find that getting right mentorship, supervision, discipline, it's all important. It's all important, you know. Otherwise, you're going to flounder and you're going to fail. You're going to sink here. This world designed to sink you, actually. Sink you into a very dark hole, black hole of despair. It's absolutely designed for that. It intrigues us and attracts us towards this goal. So there are a lot of people in this world who are really desperate and stuck, and they say, I just don't know exactly what to do. I just don't get it. This is very common. This is my experience in the world. I've been through all this experiencing. And so when you make the acquaintance of a Dharma King, then it changes everything. It's like you go to a university and you're floundering. I don't know what I'm going to do. I don't know how to make my way, how to succeed through the system. And then you happen to be befriended by the president of the university or the dean or something, someone, you know, really high up. Takes a liking to you. Maybe you meet them at the university cafeteria. They happen to go there, and you sit down next to them or something. They sit down. You mind if I sit here? And you say, oh, sure. Oh, wow. You don't know who they are necessarily at first, and you're chatting for a while, and you say, what do you do? I say, well, I'm the president of the university. Huh? Yeah. And so, what do you do? Well, you're a student, right? Oh, great. And you're just chatting like normal folks. And then the president of the university knows your name, knows your face, and they see you and they say, hey. Every time they see you, they make a point of, hey. And they see you at the cafeteria, they come over, hey, how you doing? You know, and sit down and they chat and they say, you know what? What do you want to do here? I said, you know what? There's a professor. It'd be really great if you took their class. I think that you would really mesh great with that professor, you know? So I'll see to it that you, you know, if you want to get in, I'll make sure you get into that class. Right? And then it happens. You get into that class because you have the president of the university having your back. And they go to the professor, say, hey, professor, you know, you have room for one more student? Wow, it's really full class. He says, well, can you squeeze one more in for me? It's a friend of mine. The professor says, oh, sure. Yeah, I can squeeze one more in my class. No problem. You see how that works? So the president of the university, he's friends with all the professors and everybody, the heads of this and this and that, and they go to him and says, hey, could you do me a favor? I got this friend of mine that I think would really, you could help him out if you gave him a hand. And they're going to say, oh, of course I will. Longchenpa goes to Jamyang Kyentse Choki Lodo and says, hey, Jamyang, could you do me a favor? I got this knucklehead out in California that's, I kind of like him. So, you know, he needs some supervision, some direct supervision. Could you give him some direct supervision? And Jamyang says, oh, yeah, absolutely, of course, yeah, sure, anything for you, anything you want. So you see how that works? So the Dharma Kings are looking for promising, those very, you know, promising, those who show promise, those who are showing promise, which is everyday practice, is they're looking for this perseverance in you, this perseverance, this stick-to-itiveness. They're looking for stick-to-itiveness, not fixation, But stick to itiveness and willingness to listen to the Holy Spirit and try something different, this and try this, and the Holy Spirit wants you to do this. And the flexibility, mental flexibility, stick to itiveness, resolve, determination. And all that, they're looking for that. So that's very promising. They see something that's very promising. They're going to come up and introduce themselves to you. And you don't know who they are initially, maybe. And maybe later on you'll find out. That happened to me, Ram Maharshi, in a dream where he gave me this tremendous boost of reassurance and made it clear that he's aware of what I'm doing, very much aware, very, and absolutely... I could tell that he's very aware of what I'm going to do, and he totally approves of it, and is thrilled by it, and he's going to continue to be aware of it, and he let me know all of this, and I didn't know who it was. And then later on, maybe months later, I found out it was Ram Maharshi, and I was just like, wow. So you may not know initially who it is. Same with Longchenpa. He didn't say, hey, I'm the omniscient Dharma King Longchenpa. No, he just came up and started chatting with me. And I started chatting with him, asked him questions. He answered. He was very just relaxed and affable and friendly and didn't put on airs, didn't have all these, all the religious garb on or anything. Nothing. He just acting like just a regular Joe, just chatting with me, because I seem to be an interesting person. He feels like chatting with me. Then later on, I found out it was Longchenpa. It's like, well, holy cow. But the way they present themselves is so casual and just appropriate. You realize, hey, they're not these, there's no awe. I don't have awe of them, because we have a friendship. They approach me as a friend, instead of as some devotee, but no, not as a devotee, as a friend. Like they took an interest in me. It's like they took an interest in me. That's how it works. That's how it's worked with me. They took an interest in me. They said, well, they made it clear that they enjoy speaking, talking with me. They enjoy it. So they put themselves at the same level. They level themselves to where you're to you. And at the same time, their presence is felt by you. It's just, wow, it's perfect. It's a perfect presence. But they know that you also have perfect presence. So knowing that, they don't put on airs at all with you. They don't put on any airs. They know they're speaking with someone equal to them. And it's a thrill for them to be able to do that, because most of us are trying so hard to be greater that we're scared by any talk of this equality, and so we won't listen to them. And so they're thrilled when they're able to greet us and speak with us. They really love it. They're very grateful for it. Very grateful for it. This is what Ramana showed me at my birthday. He just let me know just how grateful he was for everything I've been doing. For him and for the Dharma Kings and just in general, and that my accessibility and willingness to ask him for help and all this, he's just so thrilled about that. He just loves it. He can't thank you enough. That kind of feeling of someone that just can't thank you enough for it, that you talk about, very amazing experience. And we might wonder, how come the Dharma Kings, we don't get to see them very often? And because we don't allow them to be grateful to us. We keep thinking, no, I'm the one who's grateful to you. No, they want to express their gratitude to us. That's how Jam Yang approached me, is just just pouring out gratitude towards me. Because Longchenpa, you know, must have told him, you know, here's someone who's just like working so hard to further the Dharma, you know, that matters most to Longchenpa. And that's what Jamyang's all about. And so he just, you know, was just overwhelmed with gratitude, and to the point of just weeping profusely. I was like, oh, come on, you know, you're the man, you know, not me. But I let him, you know, let him express his gratitude. And this is the key. If you want to meet the Dharma kings, let them express their gratitude to you for allowing them to greet you. This is the secret to it. It's very humbling. It's very humbling. But it's necessary, because the key is they are helping you realize that you too are a Dharma king. And we're all Dharma kings, actually. Right this moment we are. We're all Dharma kings this very moment. We're all Bodhisattvas this very moment. This is a fact. And so your willingness to at least entertain this notion, you know, to them, this is all important to them. And they're just, you know, super grateful that you would make the effort to do this, because they understand it's quite an effort. It's quite difficult for us. In some way, they come to have darshan of you. And the challenge is for you to allow it. So it's amazing. You become functionally, pragmatically a Dharma king, a Bodhisattva, Dharma prince, Bodhisattva, Dharma king ultimately, by being willing to allow these Dharma kings to have darshan of you. That's how you do it, actually. Now, priest was speaking of humility, you have to be humble. Well, yes, yes and yes. And you also need to bear witness to the effectiveness of the Holy Spirit in your life. Well, it wouldn't do any good if after a lifetime of effort of allowing the Holy Spirit to listen to the music is playing for me, if I were to say, oh, I haven't gotten anywhere, you know, I'm really nothing, I'm no good, I failed, and I'm, you know, all this sort of humility, like, oh, I'm not really, you know, what is that? That's discouraging everybody. Instead, you should say, the Holy Spirit's done a fantastic job with me, just an absolutely stellar job, which it has. This is what encourages people. So you, false humility is very bad sin, actually. It's very bad. So we have to recognize clearly what we mean by humility. So, really, the gurus you really want to find are the ones that really want to have darshan of you, not the ones who claim that they're here for you to have darshan of them. Okay. Those are not the genuine gurus. At least it would seem that way, right? We don't want to denounce anyone, but be on the safe side, okay? Err on the side of caution if you want to look at it that way. People thought that they were going to see darshan of Sri Srinandamaya. No. She was the one who was, she said she was the one who's having darshan of all of you that came to see me. She said, I'm just so overjoyed. You can't even know the love I feel and how thrilling this is for me just to be able to have darshan of all of you. This is a genuine guru. when the guru comes to you, they're really saying, I've wanted to have darshan of you for so long, and finally I get it. It's so great. And I would say, you know, well, I'm, you know, it's. I wish, if it would have been sooner, that would have been great, right? And I know I'm apologize for keeping you waiting so long. That is for sure. So this is worth trying in your life. It's very much worth trying. I'm certainly going to try it. Holy Spirit's bringing this to my attention. It's very important. The gurus are searching for you, for who will allow them to have darshan of you. Who is it in the world that will allow these Dharma kings to have darshan of them? That's what they're looking for, actually. And we're saying, well, I'm not ready yet. You know, I'm not ready yet. But really, so I'm not ready to have your darshan yet, teacher. Still got to work on stuff. And they say, but that's not what I'm asking. Can I have darshan of you? That's what I want. You see, by doing this, you realize who you are. This great Dharma king is pleading, begging. Sri Sri Narayana would beg. She begged. She turned herself into a beggar for our darshan. So let us not keep making her beg. Give it to her. Let her have it. Let her have our darshan. Our viewing, our spiritual viewing. So instead of you going to see some guru who's sitting on a throne saying, I'm granting you darshan, all you poor, foolish, deluded devotees who need this all-powerful guru and the shakti of the guru, and you need to come see me, and that's what's going to enlighten you. Instead of that, okay, just the opposite of that. Just say, I'm willing for all you Dharma kings to have darshan of me. And so you have an audience of Dharma kings having darshan of you. This is how you're supposed to do it, actually. Just let this sink in. It's a rare treat for them, is it not? How often have you heard it spoken of like this? So when the guru appears, don't just go full stop in the wow. Don't do anything. They're here to have your darshan. Let them have it. for as long as you can. So you sit quietly so they can have your darshan. You're not rushing off doing things. Oh, yeah, I'm busy. I gotta go. All right, they want your darshan. Let them have it. Just sit here quietly. So enable that. So what really helped highlight this recently was Jamyang Khyentse Choekyi Lodro coming to me in a dream. And the way he approached me was so, I was so surprised. It's not like, oh, here's some great guru coming, giving the opportunity to bow to them and have darshan of them. It's just the opposite. He was coming to have darshan of me. He was just thrilled. It's like, what? I don't have any attainments. I'm not the guru. You are. And but I said, yeah. So will you at least grant me something? I want to have your darshan because it's something very rare that no one, almost nobody grants them. Because they see you as an equal. And it's a great blessing to have an opportunity to see someone equal and not have them try and jump in the way of it, right? California dreaming again here, folks. I'm telling you. Suddenly the weather just shifted today. It was like 90 plus, and it was just a soft, cool breeze. I mean, it was just really something. And it just feels beautiful right now. Out of the gloom, and into just gorgeous, sublime weather. Which we are certainly used to. That's one thing about here. It's like the world is having darshan of us. California is like the world having darshan of us out here. And this beautiful weather is the perfume of the darshan. Something like that. The world is so happy. Oh, can I just... This happiness is expressed in the weather here. It's like the gratitude from the world. That terrible cold, damp, foggy weather we had before. Someone just told me today, I got another chance meeting, a chance meeting. You know, the Holy Spirit set it up. And this very damp weather actually caused him severe troubles. A lot of pain, suffering. He had to do some exercise. He was doing something that it ended up actually really causing him a lot of suffering. He's still suffering from it. Very interesting. So we must be careful that this teaching of humility doesn't go too far and oversteps its boundaries. And ultimately, we need to turn everything completely upside on its head, flip the whole thing, and realize and put ourselves at the center and let the gurus have darshan of us. And this is how we wake up and realize we're all equal. We're all perfect. How else, what's better than having those who realize they're perfect and all are perfect to come to see you and insist they really wanted to have darshan of you? Well, that must mean you're perfect too. They just love to see your perfection. You know, they're seeing you truly. And they're thrilled that you're given the opportunity to witness to your perfection. You see? And then this is what wakes us up and we realize that everyone's perfect right now. So this is the sure way, the fast way, the sure way. Let the Dharma Kings have your darshan. It's the best, fastest, safest, awesome way there is. And so many, I don't hardly know anyone, that there's only a few that allow that. Those are the fortunate ones. They're on the fast track. Instead of helping them out, I mean, instead of asking them, can you help me out? Can you help me out? Instead of pleading, tell them, no, you know what? I'm going to help you out. I'm going to do something for you. I'm going to help you out. I'm going to let you have my darshan of me. I'll help you out that way. Talk about flipping the script, right? But this is what actually works. Give them that opportunity. Give them that opportunity. I will try. I'll keep trying. And see what happens here. But we're trained to say that's totally arrogant and haughty. So imagine coming into this world with this knowledge of this is the real path and trying to explain it to the world. Wouldn't they think that you're just absolutely the most arrogant person that's ever been born and the most selfish, egotistical, arrogant? You know, they need to take you down? Isn't that what the world would do? Yes, it is. That's what the world is trying to do. To me, for sure. That's why it's so difficult to get this information out to the world. Yeah, it's like, who in the world do you think you are that the gurus won't have darshan of you? What a joke. And they view it from the ego standpoint, and they're just like, ridiculous. But we've clearly shown here, it's not ridiculous at all. In fact, it's the height of wisdom. It's the sure thing. Of course, the ego doesn't like that, does it? It doesn't like the sure thing. It wants your path to be difficult. Slow you down as much as possible. Going slow with the skateboard, going slow. And it's, when you're on hard surface, you know, it moves. It doesn't stop moving easily. You got to be moving with it. You can't jump on it and not be in a moving mood, a gliding mood. You have to be in a gliding mood, and you really have to start feeling that. As this teacher, skateboard teacher, expert said, and I understand now what he's saying, I get it. He says, kids come to me all the time. They want to learn all these tricks. And I tell them, look, first, just push your board. Push your board all over the place every day. Just push your board all every day all over the place. Just, that's the best practice of all, which is what I want to do. But he says, the kids say, no, I want to do this. I want, these tricks are so cool. I want to impress, you know. And they said, no, first you need to be really comfortable pushing. Okay, ride push. And then at some point when you're so comfortable with that, then, you know, introduce a few tricks. And but yeah, that's true, isn't it? You have to be in the mood of gliding. You have to get that feel of I'm on the move. You know, I'm gliding through life on these wheels. Not that I'm trying to do some trick. So, you know, I have to get in that mental frame of mind. I'm looking for some place to ride. And so far I haven't found it. We'll see. I'll start looking into it. Let's start looking into it, actually. I just need to start writing, just pushing, and just keeping it real simple. But you just have to start getting a feel for it. Meanwhile, in practice, fitness and balance and all that kind of stuff, and tumbling and rolling. Holy Spirit wants me to roll. Got me something here today to help me just roll, do some more rolling. I did some rolling. That's very interesting. Roll. You don't roll your boat gently down the stream. Merrily, life is but a dream. Verily, roll your boat gently down the stream. Verily, life is but a dream. Yeah. Oh, and I keep meeting people and they keep telling me the same thing. The most important thing in fitness is drink water. Drink water. A lot of water. That's the most important thing. Someone told me, he said, I don't even drink all those sports drinks and blah, blah, blah. I said, no, water. And it keeps being reinforced to me. Hydrate. Hey, it keeps coming at me so many times. I got to listen to this. But what does it mean spiritually? Interesting, right? It means keep it bare bones. You don't have to keep doing all this sugar coating stuff, you know, sugar water, flavored water, juice this. Just water. Keep it the most basic possible, just super basic. Water is just unadorned. It's totally unadorned. So just focused on this unadorned truth. Okay, see how I can do that. Just stick with water. That's the best. And someone told me this today, and I sort of understood what he was saying. That when we're really hydrated, it helps us in so many ways. We're meant to be hydrated. That was kind of boring, drinking water all the time. Well, you could get into it. I'm going to try. Hydrate. Yeah, I've had, again, people from all walks of life just tell me this. What's the secret to singing? Hydration is the number one. Water just got to, really, it's super important. It takes you several days to get hydrated of drinking a lot. And most people are chronically underhydrated, actually. Dehydrated. Yeah, amazing. So, an amazing taping here. Just astonishing. I don't want to get too tired. I could go on, but it's a good time to wrap it up here. If we can get to this, allow the Dharma Kings to have darshan of us. You know what? That's going to save your life. That flips the script on the world so severely. It saves your life. It saves you from the world. You're saved from the world. You're a savior from the world by just allowing it, taking this one step. Let the Dharma Kings have darshan of you. Take this one step. Then you're a world savior. It's the one thing the ego can't handle, isn't it? The ego turns us away from this by any means it possibly can. So I came into the world to deliver this truth, and what did the ego do? It says you're horrible, you're terrible, you're so arrogant, but you have such a high opinion of yourself. This is ridiculous. You know, this, who are you to what have you accomplished? Where are your attainments? Blah 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 blah. And so the ego is just, you know, very much opposed to it, as you would imagine, because it's so, it's the heart of success, to liberation, yeah, from pretension, pretending that we're not already perfect. But message is being delivered. It's hard to be a messenger of this message, I'll tell you that. That is for sure. The whole world's against you. All the gurus are against you. Well, most of them, certainly, against you. You know, you're supposed to be this good little devotee and support them in every which way, their greatness, and just let the Dharma Kings have your darshan. Don't mess around with anyone else. Don't mess around. You know, it's tricky. It's tricky. So don't let it be tricky. As Jesus said when he came back, he said, I'm back and I'm here to relate with all of you as friends. And that's all he said. That must mean, that he means, must mean what he says. I mean, if that's all he said, that must be it. I mean, there's nothing more for him to say. He said what he wanted to say. I'm back and I'm here to relate with you as friends. That's it. So we better take that to heart. Better take that to heart. And we've been treating him as a great friend for so long, you know. It's time for us to give him an opportunity to treat us as his great friend, right? Because that's what we really are. We're all his great friends. And time to let him express that. The gratitude that he has towards us for the willingness to accept, you know, his love and gratitude for just simply for what we are, which is the one sonship of God. We're very precious to Jesus. Every single one of us is very precious. We're very precious to all the Dharma Kings. They view us as extraordinarily precious. And we are, actually. Ultimately, we are because we're perfect. And the gifts that we give everyone are extraordinary, so beautiful. And they know this. So they crave our gifts. And we're not quite, you know, functioning quite as beautifully as we could be, as we pretend that we're not what we really are. So they just, you know, craving our beautiful contributions to the oneness. What did I do today that I'm so tired? Oh, yeah. My arm is just like, gas station workout. This is part of my life now. You talk about making your path interesting and be a genius. Allow the genius of the Holy Spirit to help you out. One day the Holy Spirit, there are these U-shaped ball yards or something like that, real like maybe 6-inch or 8-inch pipe in a U shape, cemented into the ground to prevent cars hitting the gas pumps. It's protection barrier. You see them at the end caps of the gas pumps in a gas station. You'll have these. What do they call them? Standards or something. There's some name for them. And so they're in this nice U-shape. And so what I do is I put my back against the side of a gas pump and then fall with my hands onto this standard or whatever you call, I don't know, they call it standard, and then go down and go my chest down to like a push up thing, and then push back up strongly, push back up and push myself back up so that I'm leaning against the gas pump again, the side of the gas pump. So gas station push ups, and what I do is I just keep doing these until the I'm filling up the vehicle until it clicks and stops, and when it stops, oh, okay, I stop. I decided to do this now. So today I did 35 of those. I started out, when I first started doing this, I did 10. And that was very difficult. I was like, wow, I did 10. And finally, I decided one day if I had to do 20. And then just recently, a couple of days ago, I decided I'm going to try and just keep doing them until the gas stops filling up. And I did like 30-something. Today I did 35. That was like just a little over half a tank or something. I don't know. So there's more to come. I mean, if I'm really on empty, I maybe have to do 50 of these or something. It's going to be interesting. But it really, you know, it really helps your fitness. And so what would you be doing otherwise? You'd be standing there by the gas pump, you know, pumping the gas, just standing there watching the things turn. Okay, there's 10 gallons, 11 gallons, okay. You're just sitting there. Everybody sits there. You might be cleaning your windows or something, but most people just sort of stand there and just wait. And for me, I use those like 3 minutes or something to get a tremendous, you know, upper body workout, really. It's really tremendous. You can have fun with that. I push up and clap in between each one. Now, just whatever you do, something, just make it fun for yourself. So it's intriguing to you and interesting to you. Make your path fun. You have to. Be contracted in by your own path, that it's very interesting to you. You take delight in it. Delight in your path. So that's why I feel tired here. And then my legs feel tired because of, you know, working on trampoline. Yes, and falling down dead. Yeah, I did a bunch of, so yeah, I managed to get a workout today with Hardy, not even knowing it hardly. So you have a busy life, right? Well, guess what? You can still get in some inspiring workouts, which help you be less robotic as you fit them into your life, and let the Holy Spirit, the Holy Spirit can use exercise in certain ways to help you wake up, actually. Yeah, the Holy Spirit can use all sorts of things, all sorts of activities and non-activities and everything. Can use everything. Everything's grist for its mill, for its grace. And, you know, if you add those up, every time you get gas, you do that, you know, over months and months and months and months, you know what? Your upper body's going to get stronger and stronger and stronger and stronger. The ability to push yourself up from the ground, that's a very great exercise to feel that you have the ability to, you fall dead, you're lying down, and can you push yourself back up like that? Oh, yeah, I can do that. And psychologically, it's very interesting the effect it has on you. A very deep positive effect somehow. Oh, I fell down, but I can push myself right back up. Wow. Wow, 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 wow. So today I didn't eat very much. I mostly drank water. Because I've been eating too much. I gained 5 pounds. I knew I was doing it. The Holy Spirit pointed out to me. It was amazing. Someone came up to me and asked about a diet. I said, I really want to know, what kind of advice do you have for a diet? And I gave him all this advice. I said, first thing, no snacks. Cut out this and this. And I said, what do you do? He said, well, I snack. What do you eat? Well, I eat peanuts. I said, well, you got to knock that out. Well, son of a gun, if that isn't exactly what I've been doing the last couple of weeks, is having all these peanuts and eating these peanuts. So the Holy Spirit was telling me, follow your own advice. I was giving this advice to someone, and it turns out that was the exact advice that I'm supposed should be following, because I've been snacking and eating peanuts, doing the exact thing I told them not to do, I've been doing. And then I realized that. I said, oh, wow. Yeah, the Holy Spirit's telling me, knock it off. So I'm trying to knock it off now. And today's the first day of that. And I feel pretty hungry. But I was getting into bad habits. Chocolate, peanuts, snacking, potato chips. All sorts of little finger foods and snacks all the time. Is it eating too much? There's no doubt about it. Snacks are what really do you in. Crackers. I was starting to go back to crackers. That really will mess up your diet and help cause you to gain weight. For some reason, it really does. Chocolate's always a warning. For me, that's a warning sign. That means I'm somehow losing my resolve, going back to chocolate. And that's what I've done. So I have to get it back again. Time to get it back, as we know. Head into September. Get ready to head into September. Labor Day. After Labor Day, all hell's going to break loose. You might expect that, actually. And so let your path be, keep your path super interesting to you. Make your path very interesting in 360 degrees so nobody can swoop in and say, hey, you know, and lead you astray by the Pied Piper leading you astray into the black hole of despair because they intrigued you with some dietary thing or something like that, that instead of you letting the Holy Spirit play the song of your nutrition, of your exercise, of this and this and this. And of course you can get tips. The Holy Spirit will lead you. I mean, so constantly leading me to stuff, say, look at what they're doing, look at what they're doing. And then there's nothing wrong with that. But stay intrigued by the Holy Spirit, okay? Let the Holy Spirit be the center of your life. Let the Holy Spirit play the piano. And then you follow its advice so you can stay very much involved with your path and not let the world sweep you away like a tsunami, because a tsunami is coming in this world, capable of sweeping you away if you're not really trusting in the Holy Spirit. So just trust it, okay? Trust in the Holy Spirit. That is the fundamental key to it all. Trust in the Holy Spirit. Trust in the grace of God. Let the grace of God play the music and you listen to it. It's that simple. All right. Very great. That's it for this one.